You're listening to the Truckers Network radio show on TNCRadio.live, where we offer news, weather, traffic, information, and entertainment our commercial drivers like to hear. I'm Shelley Johnson. For over 30 years, the Fabulous Thunderbirds have been the quintessential American band. The group's distinctive and powerful sound has been influenced by a variety of musical styles. It morphed itself into a unique musical hybrid with the popular barn burners Tuff Enuff and Wrap It Up. Co-founder Kim Wilson, the sole original member, still spearheads the group as it evolves into its newest incarnation, which we have information about today. Wilson's great vocals are as versatile as they are dynamic. He calls the Fabulous Thunderbirds an American music band. They tour extensively in the U.S. and Europe. We have the pleasure of speaking with Kim Wilson today on the Truckers Network radio show. Welcome, Kim. It's great having you on my show. Thank you for being here. Where did you want to start? Could we start with you? And I understand you were born in California and...
Actually, I was born in Detroit.
Oh, were you born in Detroit? Okay, I'm a Michigander too. Originally.
I was born in Detroit. Remember, we left Detroit in 1960. My dad was the GM and then we came to California. And I lived there all the way through high school and I started college and then I started playing in bands and that was it. I was in a band from 1968 to the present. And then I moved to Texas in October 1974, moved to Austin. Mm-hmm. I was in Minnesota before that for a year and a half. I couldn't take the winter. Moved down to Texas. I came to check Austin out in January of was it January? I don't know. Can't remember exactly. It was 74, the end of 74 and the beginning of 75. And we started playing at the Antone's nightclub pretty much exclusively. We had a few little gigs around. And it took us a little while to get going. But then we met Denny Bruce in 1978. And... he produced the first record on us in 79, and we did that record in Dallas, Summit Burnett Studios. Bob Sullivan was the engineer.
And that was with Jimmy Vaughn and Keith Ferguson on those two.
It was.
Yep.
Yes, and Mike Buck on drums.
Okay. So was blues rock always something that you wanted to pursue, or did it kind of evolve into that genre?
Well... let's get one thing straight here. We don't play blues rock.
Oh,
we
okay.
play blues. We play blues and we play rock and roll.
Okay.
The blues rock is not a category.
Well, it's kind of interesting because I've seen it labeled as such. So educate our listeners.
You see, we were labeled as a lot of things. We were labeled as rockabilly for a while. We were labeled as, you know, we always thought of ourselves as a blues band that played rock and roll. And blues rock was not a category when we started. And it, to me, it's not a category right now. But then, you know, we had some... So he produced that first record on us, right?
Mm-hmm.
Eddie Bruce. And Bob Sullivan was the engineer of their Summer Burnett Studios in Dallas. So that was a great experience. Because when we came in, Bob Sullivan immediately played Ride 'Em On Down by Eddie Taylor. I don't know if you know who that is, but he's a guy. So this is a guy that I worked with since I was a kid in California,
mm-hmm.
a Chicago guy that played guitar on all the Jimmy Reed records. And he was an incredible musician. Anyway, he played that record for us and we went, okay, we're going to get along just fine. And we recorded everything we knew in about 2.5 days and we kept 12 of them. And so it made it very difficult though. To do a second record because we'd already played everything we knew.
Kim, I just wanted to interject here. I've been a big fan of the Thunderbirds for years, actually since Powerful Stuff was dedicated to me.
Really?
Yes, it was, because there's a redhead in that song.
Wow. That's funny.
We'll be right back. So tell us more about your background.
We ended up making four records for Tacoma and then Chrysalis. And Nick Lowe produced the last record in that four. And that was the beginning. We had met Rockpile. We had met their manager. He had come over to see us. And then he hired us to do a whole tour with them in England. I believe that was 1980, mm-hmm. maybe 81. And we didn't really know what we were going to do after that. You know, that we ended up getting dropped by them, by Chrysalis. And we ended up going over to, we had this kind of fly-by-night label that we were had signed with. And they sent us over to England to produce, to record Tuff Enuff with Dave Edmonds. And then they went bankrupt. So we're sitting there on these masters, shopping them everywhere. I'm kind of shortening the story here, but we ended up going to New York and visiting Tony Martel over at, back then it was Columbia/Epic/CBS Records, and he brought us in. Well, this had been quite a while that we were sitting on these masters, and he said, boys, I think I can sell this. So what he did was he started up his own label within that company, CBS Associated, and we had access to all of the promotional people and all the marketing, everybody with Epic and CBS and Columbia on from coast to coast. And that the rest is history as far as the hit record goes, you know.
Oh, it was a huge hit. Number 10.
It was a big hit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
International hit.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was back in the days, you know, when they had AOR radio. So we would climb up the AOR charts, and we had several top 10 AOR hits. And then we had Tuff Enuff and Wrap It Up, and then went to CHR, and Tuff Enuff went to number 10. The song went to number 10. I think the album only went to number 13, but that was still a big thing, you know, for a bunch of guys like us, you know, who were really a blues band. Like I said, blues band that played rock and roll.
Sure.
And we've had pretty good success ever since then.
Tough enough.
I'm not a big fan of contemporary music, to be honest with you. There were a few people in contemporary music that I did like. I used to love Michael Jackson, believe it or not, and he was the king of pop, and he made some great records. And several other people that had been, you know, Robert Palmer was a big fan of ours, actually. He ended up covering one of my songs.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, and we went on tour with him also. So, yeah, we have done a lot of things. I mean, and we're still going, you know. In fact, I have a brand new band.
Well, tell us about it.
You're getting the scoop on this.
Excellent.
I have a brand new band. I met these guys, you know, unfortunately, we had to part ways with the most recent lineup. But I had to, the guys I'm going with are so good that there's no way I couldn't do it, you know. And so it's a 7-piece band, including me, 2 horns, keyboard, bass, drums, and guitar. And it's a pretty big deal. You get some, you know, one guy plays with Harry Connick Jr. And the other guy used to play with Brother Jack McDuff and the Tommy Dorsey Orchestra. Yeah, so there's a lot of great, great, great musicians there, you know. And they're all East Coast guys. They're all, except for Carl, Sonny Leland. I'm, you know, the beautiful thing about this band is that there are subs for everybody. If Jerry wants to go, has to go. Of course, if Harry Connick Jr. says, I want you on this tour, he's going to go. But right. He has a sub immediately. So that's a cool thing. I get to play with a lot of different people all the time. And, you know, the core 4 guys, myself and the guitar and rhythm section, they'll be intact, and everybody else has subs. So we like that idea. I definitely love that idea. It's a bunch of badasses, let me tell you. Yeah.
So you're going to have a lot of different musical influences there. So is the sound going to change, or can you give us a little bit of a clue there?
Well, naturally, the sound is going to change a little bit, sure. I mean, but really, as long as you got to wrap it up and tough enough in there, you can do just about anything you want. You know, I'm sorry we don't do powerful stuff anymore.
Oh, bummer. That's a good song.
But, But I'm really looking forward to this. I'm going up to the East Coast to rehearse these guys on November 12th. So we haven't done our first show yet. And first show is going to be in Florida. First official show, T-Bird show. Mm-hmm. And I haven't really, you're the first person I've told about this.
This is so exciting. Well, thank you. I love having a scoop.
Yes.
So when is the first concert? You said it's going to be in Florida. Is it going to be this year?
This year. Okay. Then we have several dates in Florida in January. Mm-hmm. And then I'm going off and doing the harmonica blowdown with Mark Hummel in January. That's mostly Northwest. And then we're doing some California shows. I would really like to debut this band at Antone's in Austin, to be honest with you. I would love for that to happen.
That would be neat.
So I'll be talking to them about that. But, you know, it's a big band. And I'm adding the horns is really going to create a wonderful perception. There's going to be a whole rebranding of the band. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about that with some investors. And so it's going to be a big deal. And I'm really looking forward to it. You know, I'm no spring chicken. This might be the last lineup I have. Could be. Never know.
Oh, no. You could be like Tony Bennett. Come on.
No, I could be. It's possible, yeah. Actually. I can't imagine doing anything else but playing, to be honest with you. But, you know, it's something I want to do. And I love to play still. I'm more enthusiastic about music than I've ever been. And I'm you know, I've had a lot of lineups in this band. You know, I've had all great world-class people, but I think this one is going to really create an incredible stir. I really believe it. And yeah, it's very exciting.
And when you're living your passion, and that's music, it comes out in what you're doing, and it makes life worth living.
Absolutely. That's why I encourage all people to do what you love. It may not be easy all the time, but it'll give you satisfaction, and it will, it's a life, you know. And if there's something that you don't like doing that you're making a living at, learn to love it and be at the top of the food chain.
Good advice.
That's where, yeah.
You know, you've worked with some greats, and I understand Muddy Waters called you his favorite harmonica player and vocalist. Now, that's pretty cool.
That's very cool. And all the people I've worked with have been very, very kind to me. I mean, I've worked with all the masters just about that you can think of. And I was very, very blessed. Clifford Antone put me in a position. Of course, before I moved to Texas, I was playing with those guys when I was in, you know, my late teens, early 20s. You know, people like Eddie Taylor and Lowell Fulson, who's a Texas guy, and Pee Wee Creighton, who was raised in Austin, born in Austin, and all kinds of great, you know, really well-known masters and, you know, some less well-known, you know. But all of them were incredible and incredibly generous with me. People that were like family to me. Muddy Waters was like daddy, you know?
No, that's really great. So he was a real mentor and champion for you then.
Oh yeah. He actually really got the band going on the East Coast. He spread the word. And when we got to the East Coast, there were a lot of people there to listen to us. So, very happy about that. Very just, that's really something that no one can take away from you, being involved with the people who created the music in the first place.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And it's, yeah, and so it's very, very, it was very, very important to me. Actually, I didn't even care about an audience back then. You know, I just cared about pleasing them. And that's just the way it was. I had to have their stamp of approval. Otherwise, I don't think I'd keep going with it, you know? So it was a big, big, big honor, and, you know, being able to work with these guys and just hang out with them, it was an incredible honor.
I would think that would be a real confidence booster. If you got their approval, you knew you were on the right track.
That's right. And I think that, you know, like I say, I probably wouldn't have gone on with music had it not been for those guys. I believe that.
And you also recorded an album with Muddy Waters' son, Mud Morganfield.
I did, yeah. You know, and these things, they don't just fall in your lap. You have to work hard, and you have to hone your craft. You have to be at the top of the food chain. And when these guys are placing you at the top of the food chain, it's a very special thing.
Oh, yeah. Question is, how do you stay at the top of the food chain? That's always a challenge.
Well, that's a good question. And, you know, you just keep, when you're my age, you're not supposed to get worse. You're supposed to just keep getting better and better and better. And the chase is everything. And I think the chase to be one of those guys and not everybody else, that's the chase. I think, you know, you have to create your own identity. You have to, like I say, be at the top of the food chain on your instrument and just keep striving to be the best you can be.
So do you practice every day?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't practice every day. I pick it up and I'll play around with it. And there are some backing tracks. You know, COVID has been a disaster for people who like playing live. I mean, it's been a disaster. And so we, you know, I'll play around, you know, I've done some online things, but basically I play around the house and, you know, not every day though, you know, I don't need to anymore. You got to keep your chops up. You got to keep your physically able to be able to do it. I was just on tour on the East Coast with a lot of the guys that are the Thunderbirds now. Mm-hmm. And I had like 11 out of 12 days working, you know, so that kind of, I played myself into shape there, but, you know, to be in game shape, you got to be in a game.
Right.
That's all there is to it. You can't get in game shape playing around the house. It just can't do it. So, you know, getting used to calling off a set. You know, I've never used a set list ever. So I call off the set as I see it. You know, if the audience, if they want a little more rock and roll, I'll give them that. If they want more blues, I'll give them that. And the beautiful thing about this new thing is that I'll be able to do everything to the max. You know, there are times when I take my, what I call the blues all-stars out. That's not going to happen anymore. I won't have to. I'll have all the guys being able to do everything I want them to do. And that's very gratifying. You know, no diffs on the any of the ex-guys, especially the recent guys. I loved them. They were wonderful people, and they were great musicians. But I just had to do this. It was something I had to do.
It sounds like it's going to be a wonderful evolution, and I certainly can't wait to hear some of the music. When do you think you're going to have maybe an album?
Well, you know, we'll see. I'm not sure exactly when we're going to record it. You know, I might be doing my solo career now, which is kind of on hold, but I'm in the short list of the long list of the Grammy nominations now for my most recent solo record. And it's on MC Records. It's all traditional, very traditional, all the way down to being mono live in the studio.
Ooh.
No overdubs at all. And now he wants me to do a New Orleans record. And we were going to go down to New Orleans and record it. And then this big storm came in, and that's kind of on hold. But so that could be the next project, although we're going to be working on doing some writing for the new Thunderbirds now. You know, we were supposed to go out with this guy named Krish Sharma. He was the producer of the blues record that the Stones won a Grammy on, their blues record. And so he's a real producer, and we'll see what happens. You know, nothing's written in stone at this point. But we need to be writing, and we need to be getting ready, get these guys in gear to do something very special. You know, we were planning on having a bunch of guest artists, and so you never know. Never know who it's going to be. We've had a lot of volunteers already. And
that's what makes life exciting.
I can't really divulge the volunteers, but they're famous.
Sure. Like I said. Excellent. Well, I'm excited. I can't wait to hear what you folks put together, because it sounds like it's going to be a real great, great combination, a great synergy.
It's serious.
That's magical.
It's very serious. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It is. It's got to be, you know, we don't even know how magical it's going to be, because we haven't even played anything together yet. But all the pieces are there. And I'm really looking forward to getting it going.
Well, I know you've had some great opportunities, and you've done a lot of fabulous things, being the Fabulous Thunderbirds. Certainly Tuff Enuff was in a couple movies.
And yes.
I'm seeing in 1983, you were featured on a Santana album.
That's right. Yeah, I have been on hundreds of records, hundreds. Mark Knopfler comes to mind, Paul Simon, Bonnie Raitt. I was on two of her records. I've been on hundreds of records. I can't even, you know, there's so many of them that it's kind of overwhelming to even think about it. But all the way from people like Willie Big Eye Smith and Matt Guitar Murphy to Paul Simon and Bonnie Raitt, Mark Knopfler. I was on a Clapton record also.
Yes.
So my discography. There's no one that's even come close to getting my whole discography documented. I'm sure of that. But it's been fun.
And it shows how talented you are and versatile, which is very cool.
You know, my secret, I'll tell you, I don't really have to change much in what I do. You just have to know how to harmonize with other musicians. And if you do that, then they really call you in to do what you do anyway. I mean, Paul Simon was a little bit of a taskmaster. How about Eric Johnson? I was on one of his records. I've got a gold record sitting on my wall right now from Eric Johnson under an alias. Dave Edmonds, I was on one of his records. So, I mean, you know, there's been a lot of albums that I've been on that it's always an honor, you know, always an honor to be on these records. And I'm very, very thrilled to always get the call. And it's really a wonderful feeling.
And I imagine sometimes it's a bit daunting if it's a big star. When you first started doing that, I'm sure you kind of was a little nervous, maybe, or
no, I wasn't nervous, but I got right down to business, so you know, because you want to get called back.
Exactly, you're only good as good as your last job, right?
That's right. It's always an audition, right? Always an audition. And I don't care how many years you've been in the business, it's always an audition. You know,
a new song. Life is an audition, right?
Only dogs give unconditional love, okay?
True.
So you know, you need to get out there and just, like I say, stay at the top of your game and be ready to go no matter who calls, and be ready to get on a big stage or the small stage, whatever stage you're going to be on. You know, just be at the top of it. Give them 200%. That's what you got to do.
Excellent. Is that the advice you give maybe some aspiring musicians? Because there are plenty out there that are trying to figure out how to take on all of that.
Well, I will say, you know, young musicians, listen to the masters. You know, you can go anywhere if you're well-versed in traditional music. You can't go anywhere, in my mind, if you're not well-versed in traditional music. And I think that's the problem these days, is a lot of these young people, they go right to, you know, they think they're going to get on a tour bus after playing for 3 months. And some of them do. But when you grow up, you got to learn how to play. Otherwise, it's going to be a miserable life for you. And I think that to be a real musician and a journeyman musician, it's a beautiful life to have. There's no question about it. And I've always aspired to that. I've always wanted to be one of the masters. I've never wanted to be anybody else. And it's very, very, very important to me.
What would you say was the most exciting in your climb?
Oh, man, that's hard. That's so difficult to say. I mean, you know, when Muddy Waters tells you you're the best since Little Walter to your face.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty big. Okay. Oh, yeah. And, you know, when he's telling you to stand up in the audience after you've opened up for him at Antone's and saying, hey, and they're doing a Little Walter song, I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about it. And when he says, stand up, Kim, I want to introduce the closest guy I've heard to Walter, and I just heard him tonight. And stand up, Kim. And boy, you know, I mean, it doesn't get any bigger than that. Yeah. You know, when B.B. King says that kind of stuff about you, and I was on a B.B. King record, actually. So that was incredible, too. All these things, really, I got to say, those things totally, they stand above everything else, even hit records. I mean, it was great to see them a Tuff Enuff climb to the top 10. Great. But it was, compared to Muddy Waters saying that kind of stuff about you and people like B.B. King and James Cotton. And, you know, I mean, there's really... you got to get your ducks in a row when you start thinking about that kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah.
That automatically puts your ducks in a row.
That's something you'll keep for a lifetime.
You know? They can't take it away from you.
That's
yeah.
Right. That's right.
Say no to me. Stand back, I'm coming. up in life, you got to help yourself. That don't mean you have to step on no one else. Go for it, man, you got nothing to lose. But don't let nobody step on you. Stand back, I'm coming through. Stand back, I know just what to do. Stand back, let me make my way. Stand back, listen to what I say. I ain't gonna run and hide. You think I am, you better step aside. I ain't gonna turn me other cheek. If you want the world, you can't be me. You can't get by if you don't take a chance. You got to be the fiddler if you want to dance. I learned my lesson a long time ago. You got to keep pushing if you want it to go. Stand back, I'm coming through. Stand back, I know just what to do. Stand back, let me make my way. Stand back, listen to what I say. Mind, even if they say that you're out of line, one of these days you're gonna know the score. I'm not telling you something you don't know. Stand back, I'm coming through. Stand back, I know just what to do. Stand back, let me make my way. Stand back, listen to what I say. Stand back. Stand back, there ain't nothing to it. Stand back, let me make my way. Stand back, listen to what I say.
So what hits did you like the most? I mean, obviously, the ones that went more mainstream, Tuff Enuff, Wrap It Up, Stand Back, How Do You Spell Love, and Powerful Stuff. Was there a favorite of that grouping that you liked, and how did these songs evolve?
Well, songs kind of happen organically with me. Mm-hmm. I mean, Tuff Enuff got written on a barf bag on an airplane going from Dallas to Austin.
Oh, really? A barf bag? Oh, my goodness.
But, you know, I've got some great songs like Wait on Time and Give Me All Your Love, you know, from the very first couple records that we did that are great songs. And they've actually been covered by quite a few people. You know, I mean, as far as the hits goes, well, I got to give it to Tuff Enuff because that's just, that was a special song. And it was something that came about at the right time. People were, you know, people have been listening to us playing all over the country and all over the world for quite a while. And then all of a sudden, boom, then when that record came out, everybody wanted it. So, you know, it was a big deal. It was a big deal. It was a big deal to be on a major label, and really at the tail end of when you could actually have big hit records. Mm-hmm. Now, if you sell 50,000 copies, you're up for an award somewhere. You're gonna get a Grammy. If you sell 100,000 copies, I mean, yeah, it's gonna really be great for you. So, to do over a million copies and you know, watch that record climb and still being added to P1s a year later. P1, you know what a P1 is, of course, or was. I'm not even sure if P1 exists anymore, you know. But it's a top 40 station, and you know, watching it climb up, it was incredible, too. You know, there's a lot of incredible things that have happened in the evolution of this band. And I think, you know, I'm not going to jinx it by saying it's going to be the best it's ever been, but it sure looks great on paper.
So where do people follow you so that they can actually hear the music and see you folks performing?
FabulousThunderbirds.com. FabulousThunderbirds.com. You'll be able to hear some stuff on there.
Oh, good.
But, you know, if they want to, you know, I guarantee you people are going to be all over it on YouTube. And I've got thousands of things on YouTube. So I'm looking forward to people just filming it with their... Get an iPhone 13 if you're going to film this stuff, people, because the rest of them can't touch it.
A little commercial there.
Yeah. They can't touch it. You can't tell. I'm talking to you on it right now, but
it sounds great.
It's an incredible phone. You want to put a camera up and a video? Wow.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's movie quality, you know?
I wish you the best of luck, the sun, the moon, the stars. I think that it's going to be really cool, this new band combination.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it myself, really looking forward to it. And I want to thank you for calling me.
Yes, well, thank you for being on the show, Kim. This has been an honor, and our listeners are going to love your music, too. And guess what? Maybe you're going to make a whole resurgence and be the thing worldwide.
I like the way you talk.
I really do appreciate it, Kim.
No, I appreciate it. Thank you for having me. It was a great interview, and I appreciate everybody down there in Houston. And is that your listening audience, or are they all over the world?
North America. We have drivers in Canada and North America, and, of course, Houston, too. So, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I love everybody down there in Houston, and well, everybody in North America and in the world. I will be talking to you soon. It's a pleasure.
Thanks so much, Kim. You've been listening to Kim Wilson from the Fabulous Thunderbirds on the Truckers Network Radio Show. I'm your host, Shelby Johnson. You're listening to TNCRadio.live. Thank you for listening to another great interview on TNCRadio.live and the Truckers Network Radio Show. All of the material you hear on TNCRadio.live, on our website, our broadcasts, or our podcasts are copyrighted. There can be no distribution without the express consent of TNCRadio.live and its partners. For inquiries, write us at info@TNCRadio.live.